Yes.
Okay. First of all, thank you very much to the organizers for giving me an opportunity to present whatever small understanding I have in the topic of additive manufacturing and 3D printing. So the topic which was given to me was pretty interesting. So they said that it has to be on non-engineering applications. So being an academician and working for working in the area of manufacturing, we have been always focusing on how to do primary structure materials and how do you make small prototypes for it. So it was pretty interesting and it gave me a lot of learning also. I referred so many websites and there are so many new processes which have come into existence. So let me first give you two, three examples and move on. The first example which I would like to give it to you is one of my friend who is remotely staying in a village near to my hometown, who is a jewelry maker. He's a jewelry maker. And this man, recently what he did was, he somehow got to know about this additive manufacturing and then he called me. And then he said, see, I would somehow try to use additive manufacturing and enhance my business. So when he said that, I said, okay, I don't know how do you do it, but this is what is additive manufacturing all about. I explained to him. So then he said, okay, wonderful. Let me start using it. So what he did earlier, what he used to do is he used to make freehand sketches of these designs. And by the way, when I say very close to my remote village and all, his annual turnover is more than a crore, by the way. He's a gold jewelry person. He runs a shop and other things. So what he does, what he generally do is he does a freehand styling of the ornamental, whatever it is, let it be a pendant, let it be a earring, let it be whatever it is. He just does a freehand and then shows his freehand and he colors the freehand very nicely. And then he shows it to the customer and he says, these are some of the new models which I am going to release. And then that's how he gets the clearance from the customer and then he starts. When I told him about this, then quickly he was smart enough to grab things. He learned AutoCAD and 3D modeling. And now he could do styling of all the prototypes, whatever he want to make. And then what he did was he bought a DLP printer. DLP printer is direct light processing printer. So this printer, predominantly what you get output is a metal output. This fellow is pretty smart, a businessman. So what he did was, if he shows this plastic output to the customers, he might not get a good feedback. So what he did was, he went quickly and metallized the plastic output. There are so many processes today very easily available and which we can do. Coating of a polymer. So he did the coating of a polymer and he brought very close touch to the gold color. And now what he showed this to the customer was more impressive. Rather than virtual, rather than designing or drafting, he just showed a prototype which looked almost similar. And few of the pendants, people were so much interested, they said, we would purchase the prototype itself. So today, there is a huge, huge business using this rapid prototyping in non-engineering application. So this goldsmith is one example which I wanted to present in front of you. The other interesting thing which I wanted to present in front of you is using 3D printing, people have started printing the houses. So here what happens is, like FDM process, you mix all the cement, the ratio, whatever it is, quick cement, everything you mix. And now they put a cantilever arm and then like similar to a crane, and then they start doing printing. And interestingly, they can print houses, small stopgap houses of two rooms and three rooms within 24 hours. This is a second application which impressed me in the non-engineering application. And the third one is food industry. I'll walk through my slides, but these three impressed me like anything. The third interesting example is, people started using 3D printing for printing icing on top of a cake. Printing icing on top of a cake very beautifully, three-dimensionally, they could get it done. Initially, what this particular bakery who is there in Nagpur, what he used to do is, he used to take the birthday boy's photo and then he used to make a cake, cut out doing by subtractive process, cut out things which is all not required, and then carve the birthday boy's face on top of a cake and then start doing it. Today, what he has done is, he has made, first he makes a silicone mold, and then from the silicone mold, he tries to make the boy's from his photo a three-dimensional image. And from there, on top of it, he does use icing to give the clear texture touch of his face on top of a cake. Wonderful. So these are the three examples which really impressed me. So rapid prototyping today is a tool which is very novel, which can be used for anything and everything. So what are we as a customer supposed to do is, we should know what to do and how to use. So when we have to know what to do, say for example, you have a knife, you have a fire, you have an automobile. So you should know what to do with this automobile, and you should also know what this automobile cannot do. So you should understand the raw material used in the process, the machine tool which is available, and the third thing is the process, whatever you are trying to do in getting the output. After getting the output, the post-processing is also very important, which can help you to tweak the applications to your requirements. So let me start going through the presentation. In many fields, there is great uncertainty on whether a replacement design will actually do what is desirable. Till now, friends, we were all looking for mass production. And in mass production, we were slowly looking into economical mass production. Then we started looking into economical high quality mass production. Today, what we look forward is economic quality mass customization. Mass customization is very, very important. When you try to buy a shirt, if you fall between 40 and 42 is your size of your shoulder, the shirt which is available is either 40 or 42. When we start using a 40 shirt size, we look very odd, or when we use it at 42, we look, our appearance becomes very old. So now what is exactly required is size number 41. Same happens to the shoe. Many a times we buy a shoe pair and we say left leg is tight and right leg is loose. And we say the quality of the product is poor. Gentlemen, no. One of your left leg or right leg slightly grows lengthier, or it becomes heavier compared to the other leg. Now, when we wear the shoe, we will always feel that one is tight and one is loose. I will tell you another practical example which recently happened with my son. My son, who is studying in school, had a leg size of 6. He has a problem in using that leg size 6 because he had a flat foot or a wider foot. So the mouth of 6 is no way allowing him to use the shoe, but his length is 6. In order to accommodate the width, he has to go for a next size of the shoe. The next size of the shoe, he has almost a quarter inch ahead of his foot free. When he uses it for kicking a football, his shoe flies away. Now look at it. It is not his fault, but the product is not mass customized. And in leather industry, we look forward for mass customization. Wherever there is a change in design and you would like to quickly show it to the customer, get his feedback and fail faster, we always look for prototyping devices. So a new design often has unexpected problems. When we try to make, See, I was discussing with so many people during COVID, we developed several masks, different types of masks. In fact, IIT Kanpur, now we have started producing 25,000 masks a day in our institute itself. We have designed our machines and we have designed our masks. So it was pretty interesting when we started working. We thought this will perfectly work. When we started wearing it, we realized that there are other problems which come from the customer. So unexpected problems come. So for an unexpected problem, we would quickly show a prototype fail faster. So additive manufacturing or prototyping comes very, very handy. A prototyping is usually used as a part of the product design process to permit engineer and a designer the power to explore the design alternatives. If I show 6-7 designs in front of you, then quickly you will choose one. Or if 7 designs are in front of you, you quickly say, from A, I take this feature. From B design, I take this feature. C design, I take this feature. From D, I take this feature. So now what you do is you give it back to the producer or the designer saying that, please try to take these advantage from each of them, club it and try to make a prototype. So in that case, designer fails faster. Designer is able to accept and digest customer voice, which is very important of today when mass customization is talked about. Okay, so this is the definition of prototyping. So prototyping, according to ASTM standards, it says that you will have to draw, and then this drawn object is tessellated. From tessellation, you do slicing. From slicing, you push it to a machine, and from a machine, you try to get the output, and then you do post-processing. Post-processing is very, very important. Working with polymer is straightforward. Metallizing a polymer is a straightforward. Making a metal object is not straightforward. So make it out of prototype and polymer, metallize it. While metallizing, you can also try to diffuse color to it and then produce the output. So this is about the advantages of prototypes which have been used. A film model, for example, today, toy industry, entertainment industry, the movie industry, exhaustively uses the prototyping. Today, there are several cartoons which you see are made first with prototype, got it accepted. Initially, they used to do it virtual and then they used to see. And now what they have done is all the virtual will first be converted into a small prototype. They look at it. Once the artist looks at it, now he narrates the complete story and the capability of the toy to the narrator. And then the narrator starts writing a story. So in that way, this process of prototyping is exhaustively used in the entertainment industry. So the list of prototypes, a film prototype can be made, a feasibility prototype can be made, a horizontal prototype can be made. Okay. The next thing is rapid prototyping can be made, and simulation prototypes can also be made. So everywhere we use prototypes. So storyboard, when we say we make prototypes, virtual prototypes we make, wireframe we make, animation and mock prototypes. The difference between traditional prototyping and the conventional machine is traditional, they try to get a bulk and then they apply, they put the bulk and then they try to draw the design, whatever it is. Then they properly design the tool, the fixtures, subtract material, and finally they get the product. But whereas in rapid prototyping, they start building the prototype by using the building blocks at the required place, at the required space. They try to have a space control output and then they start doing it. It is very energy efficient, and rapid prototyping moves towards sustainability in reality. So there are several connecting applications of 3D printing. It can be in medical field, it can be in 3D software, it can also be in industry. The other big industry where today we are doing using 3D printing is in biomedical area. See, recently I was working with a set of doctors in KGMU. KGMU is King George Medical College, one of the best schools in Uttar Pradesh. So here what happens is there are, it's a government college. So patients used to get piled up. So patients from Bihar, West Bengal, they used to come here for their treatments. So when the doctors start doing these operations and when it is a critical operation, it runs to several hours. When it runs to several hours, what they do is they realize that the doctors get tired very fast and the fatigue cycle come into existence. And why is this fatigue cycle coming into existence for the doctor? Because the tool holding devices, the fixtures are not easily available. Approaching the spot is also not so easily available. So now what doctors have started doing is they take a CT scan data, use a software, convert it into a solid model. From a solid model, a tessellated file, prototype and print either the original object and see how to access it or a fixture for holding the tool. Recently, we developed a tool where in which for a colonal cancer, they need to push the camera inside and the camera has to be rotated and held at a position if they have to do operation. So we work along with them and we try to develop a fixture for them. So the moment we developed the fixture, it was a polymer. It was just a polymer. And we said, sir, it is use and throw. Use it. And we got it done so smoothly. The post-processing process, we used vapor deposition. We made a smooth anus-wise inserter. And then we made slots there. It gave a good freedom for the doctor to lock it at a position, the camera, and start using it for operation. So it was so brilliant. So this is one place where it is not used for engineering application, but used in biomedical applications. In India, so many different prototype makers are available. The FDM machine in 2000, which when I was a student, I was excited to look at an FDM machine. Stratasys was one company which was selling it in a big time at those days. They sold a machine to IIT Kanpur around about 2 crores. A pretty large machine. Today, almost a similar bed scale, almost a similar resolution and accuracy, you get it for less than 10 lakhs. So you get it for 10 lakhs. Why? The technology has come in public domain. People have understood the process. It is a competitive business. So the cost of the machine is also going down. And now there is a huge spectrum of people started working on this using prototype directly as a manufacturing. There are two kind of terminologies which has come into existence today. One is called as rapid prototyping. The other one is called as rapid manufacturing. In rapid manufacturing, I am sure Professor Karunagaran would have covered this in detail. What Professor Karunagaran does is he exactly produces what he wants on a metal to meet the requirements. That is rapid manufacturing. He is trying to develop tools, fixtures for several applications. So that is rapid manufacturing. Under rapid manufacturing, there is a subset called rapid tooling. Using the rapid prototyping and make a die and then use that die for making an object. So rapid tooling is also something which is coming up. Rapid prototyping, which was thought of, which is only for demonstration, has graduated towards rapid manufacturing and rapid tooling. These are all the makers across the globe in the business of rapid tooling. So SLA was the first process which came into existence in 1986. And here liquid polymer was used for developing prototypes. So this machine was later sold. And then in 1984, it started. And then in 1993, there was a new change which happened. So 3D printing, from rapid prototyping, we started moving into a concept called as 3D printing. So if you look at the business market in 2001, it was around about $1.1 billion. And today, what we are talking about is around about $13.3 billion. So if you look at the industry, you see automobile, and then you see medical applications, aerospace, and other common industries. Today, it has also gone into the field of education. When Atal Tinkering Labs have been talked about here and there, and we at IIT Kanpur, we are mentoring almost like 25 schools in Kanpur So what we do is we start working with the kids, and as and when the kid comes out with a wonderful idea, we start making 3D printed small prototypes for them, gears. We also make casings. We also make a gear and a casing along with a sensor integration, a packaging for battery, a packaging for electronics. We make it and give it to the school kids. They make prototypes. Recently, one of the most successful one what we made was, we made a walking stick wherein which we attached an ultrasonic sensor which can laterally as well as longitudinally measure the distance and convert that distance into sound, and a blind man will be able to get a beep sound, and that will try to vibrate his hand. A vibrator was attached, and through that he can try to use it for navigation inside a room. We are talking about navigating inside a room. That was made by rapid prototyping. We made it along with the school kids, and this was a huge hit where UP state chief minister appreciated the kids. We jointly worked with them. For them, we also use. So education is one thing where you teach them using this rapid prototyping. So that is what we did. And this is the industry which has been using it. When we talk about printing, FDM is a process which everybody knows it. And it is a very nice process. We used this FDM process as a BTEC project. We developed a small machine wherein which we used a glue gun and played with the temperature at the glue gun exit, and we could make flexible molds for ice creams, flexible molds for chocolates. So we made very flexible molds. We also made flexible molds for clay. So which we again gave it to kids to understand what is the flowability, what is the formability of different materials. So we used rapid prototyping, and here we did a small XYZ stage. We developed a small stage, and then we used a glue gun, which is 150 rupees. We used a glue gun, just tweaked with the heater and the other parameters. So we could make it, and this is used for making flexible dies. So diverse needs and need of customers and shortening of the product life cycle is pushing mass customization into customers' head. And today, every customer would like to have his or her own products. My wife has a passion towards designing her own dress. So when she starts designing her own dress, she gets more elated. So here, she does not worry about the cost. So like my wife, there are many people who are interested to design their own products. My niece and nephew, they are all studying in different engineering colleges and fashion institutes. They design their own pen stands. And they get proud of it. So when they gift it to their friends also on a birthday gift, they do a styling, they develop a prototype, and then they give it to it. So entertainment industry, gifting industry needs prototype. So this is one big area where today in non-engineering prototype is going very fast. Fast and cost-effective manufacturing technology, minimization of trials, concepts of concurrent engineering, all these things lead to a need for rapid prototype. So for rapid prototyping, it need not only start from CAD, you can also do reverse engineering. Reverse engineering is a well-accepted, ethical technique. People should use reverse engineering for understanding the state of the art technology. Moment you understand the state of the art technology, then there is a scope for improvement. When you have to improve your product or a prototype, you are first supposed to understand what is the state of the art. So this, and then you have to improvise. So reverse engineering is also used. Point cloud data, from the point cloud data, we develop surfaces. These surfaces we tessellate, slice, and give it as an input to the rapid prototyping machine. So the products can come through forward route, where point leading to line, leading to edge leading to surface leading to volume. This volume has to be watertight volume. You start developing a prototype. The other way around is point cloud data. From the point cloud data, generate a surface, surface to volume, volume to keep going. So today, both approaches are used exhaustively. So here in which I have put lot of interesting applications. Today, shoes are made out of prototyping. Shoes are made out of prototyping. So look at it. You design your own shoe. You wear a socks, and if you wear these high heel shoes, people will not be able to distinguish whether you are wearing a shoe or a rapid prototyping shoe. And earlier, these prototyping were all made out of thermosets. Today, we have thermoplast, and one step ahead, we have thermoplastic elastomers also mixed. So if you want a starting material as elastomers, which is rubber, ductility is more, you get it in the market. You get thermoplast, which is very high strength. You get thermoset, again, the highest in the strength, but no, with very less ductility. So in between the thermoplast and the elastomer, you have got a new category of material called as thermoplastic elastomers. You can use it for making these shoes. And you can see how people have used it for making the artifacts. Then if people have used the sintering techniques and people have built up veins and other small prototype boats and other things. If you look at it, the gluing technique is also used exhaustively for the artifacts which is displayed in the gardens. So this I have already explained to you. There is something called as a supporting structure. I will discuss it later if time permits. Otherwise, supporting structure comes as part of the machine tool building when you try to print the prototype. So support structure comes there. And then the post-curing is something which is very, very important. So some of the techniques which are there are stereolithography, fused deposition modeling, SLS, 3D printing, three-dimensional printing, and LOM, laminated object methods. All these techniques are used exhaustively for non-engineering applications. So SLA, I have already discussed with you. If you want to make artifacts, wonderful artifacts can be made. And these artifacts are huge business, sir. And as I told you earlier, you should understand after what you get the output from this process, exactly if you want to use it, you don't have a big market. If you can convert this by doing some post-processing techniques, so then you get a huge value addition to the product. So here are some of the things which are made out of polymer, and this is all thermoset polymer. So you also have a micro stereolithography. Micro stereolithography, what we do is rather than using a laser and writing on top of the vat of a photopolymer, we try to use micro mirrors. These micro mirrors, in a very small area, you can have 2000 mirrors. Now, these mirrors can tilt angle to between plus or minus 12 degrees. So, and this is done by electrostatic and magnetic fields. So you just tilt it by a small angle, you project it on top of a surface, you try to print the complete layer of information in one shot. So that is used exhaustively for micro stereolithography, and micro stereolithography is exhaustively used today for making stamps, and these stamps are used for making micro and nano features on top of polymers or on top of metal. So you take metal and then coat polymer on top of it, make these features. These features try to make the surface either hydrophobic or hydrophilic. Hydrophobic means it is afraid of water. That means to say the water will not get deposited. It will just roll out. A simple example is you take a windshield, which is used in aeroplanes. The windshield is made out of toughened glass. So now on top of the glass, if I can do a transparent coating, And on the transparent coating, if I can make these textures, then it tries to make the surface hydrophobic. There are certain places where you want to make the surface hydrophilic. So when you want to make it hydrophilic, that means to say the texture size and the texture can be functionally graded and hierarchically textured. So then the water gets spread on top of the surface and it tries to coat on top of the surface. A simple example is when you are started painting, many a times the paint droplets are formed and it spills down. So if you try to make the surface hydrophilic, when you try to paint, the paint smears very fast and it gets stuck very fast. So for such applications, you can also use, okay. So for micro stereolithography and nano stereolithography are available today. How come this micro and nano stereolithographies are available today? It is basically playing with the focus point of the light on top of a polymeric surface. And here the polymeric surface is liquid. It is a photopolymer. The laser is UV. You hit the UV laser on top of a photopolymer, it cures the surface and you try to get it. People have also started making here, you look at it, polymer springs. These springs are today used as dampers. Very small micro MEMS system, these are used as dampers. They are primarily secondary structures. They don't take load. They do some actuation, that's all. So you look at it, and today there is a big area which is talked about is called as metamaterial. And there is something called as aquestometamaterials. Aquestometamaterials means these material surfaces absorb sound when you talk. So there is no echo, it just absorbs sound. And once it's absorbed sound, you will not be able to get it reflected back. So where is this application? In almost all BPOs, okay, where they call, you say that, okay, SBI BPO, or you call Air India, Indigo. When they keep talking to you, you listen to a lot of background signal or noise which is coming up, which will try to hinder your conversation. So if they have these surfaces very close to the speaker, then the sound cannot travel and it becomes noise isolation. So it is exhaustively used there. So these are some of the applications where the prototyping is used for non-engineering. And it plays a very, very important role. Very important role. Then when we talk about FDM, I'm not getting into the process details. I'm just getting into the, because I was told to talk about the applications. So FDM we recently used was during this COVID, we wanted to build a lot of disinfection spraying devices. These the sanitizing units we wanted to build. So when we started building the sanitizing devices, we made the nozzles out of brass. Then at some point of time, we realized that this spraying devices tries to spray the liquid, and this liquid started giving irritation towards eye as well as on the hand. On the skin, whatever it is getting exposed. And then on top of it, a WHO also said disinfection should not be, spraying should not be used. Sanitizing sprayers should not be used because it is going to create a lot of skin irritation. So here what we found out is, if the droplet size is large, then we had a problem of a huge droplet getting hit on top of a surface and staying it on top of a skin surface. So what we did was, we started automizing the spray. So here what we did was, we could not make very small holes. So what we did was, we started getting this small hole nozzles or the needles which are available for medical applications. We pulled out that, kept in between or made it as an insert, and then surrounded by FDM, we printed the nozzle. We supported the nozzle very well. So the droplet of water which came, it was very well automized. And this automized, when it is sprayed onto the atmosphere and when it tries to hit at the person, it was not a huge droplet. So it could hit on his on a shirt and quickly evaporate. So we made several, almost like 20, 30 sprayers we made just by using FDM process. The other thing is when we were also IIT Kanpur, where we also made personal protection equipments, PPE, which is used for forefront workers during COVID application, COVID era. We were making it for frontline workers. So PPE. So when we made this PPE, we came out with a very, very simple concept. We divided the body into three parts. Okay, made one cylinder as the body, one cylinder as the hand. And we have shared this document in the public domain. You can have a look. So here, when we started doing it, the entire city was locked down. We did not have access to any industry. So what we did was we wanted to cut polymer sheets. So quickly what we did was we bought heaters from here and there. And then what we did was we made a fixture out of polymer. And then this fixture, we laid the heater. We used it for cutting the polymer packets for PPE applications. We did several iterations. And after all, several iterations, we could finally come up with our design. And we have shared this design. And our design has been very much appreciated. And it has been used. Our PPE kits, we identify a vendor and then we made it. The next thing is when we started making this face masks, also we used prototyping. So when we made this face mask, we cut using laser cutting. And then what we did was we wanted to bend, because when you put a straight line in front of your face, around the jaws, you have a free access of air coming and going. So what we did was we wanted to fold it, inward fold it, such that it goes exactly, comes like a mask in front of your face. So we wanted to make that inward fold. So again, we used this FDM process, made a die out of it, and then we fixed a small actuator to it and started folding the plastic sheets as and when it is grew and as and when it is cut. So FDM was exhaustively used during the time of COVID for non-engineering applications. Friends, I am repeatedly saying that we have to be wise. We know here is a process. This process, we should know how to tweak the process to meet our requirements. So FDM gave us this freedom. It was wonderfully done. Within 24 hours, we could make that mold. We could make fixtures. We could make the bending, folding devices. We could make it. So next one is the process for sintering. So there are, if depending upon your workpiece, depending upon the laser power, you can start using ceramic outputs, polymer outputs. So what we did was we made covers. We made a lot of covers for remanufacturing. What used to happen is we bought some foreign machines before 20 years. And these machines, over a period of time, the company ran out of business. So they have lost the business, though they have switched fields. So when we wanted to do some reverse, so this frequently these foreign machines used to get conked up because of hardware problem and other things. So what we used to do is we used to understand the hardware. We used to break it open, replace it and place it. And we used to now reduce the flexibility and make it customized to our requirements, develop a hardware circuit, keep it outside, put it inside a casing and then start using it. For making all these casings, we used to use this SLS process. Made out of polymer, or you used to make it out of ceramic. So here it also gave us a good understanding. And recently we made a ceramic heater. So what used to happen is there used to be a ceramic cover. So the front end was exposed to high temperature, and at the back end we wanted to metallize it and start using it for some use. We developed a thermocouple so that this can be used for measuring the temperature. That's an IP process we developed. So there we used it for non-engineering applications only. So these are some of the output which we have made. So rubber-like materials can be used. So today the companies have also come very interesting. Friends, I would also bring it to your kind notice. You look at periodic table, there are so many elements, right? In that so many elements, there is no one space given for polymer. Polymer is exhaustively used today. But there is no periodic table which has a polymer. We say C, we say H, we say a mixture. Polymer gives you a wonderful output. You dictate, you tailor make to your output. So when you tailor make it to your requirements, you use this process and get the output. So this is the binder jet process which is available today. The binder jet process gives you a freedom of giving color. Like your inkjet printer, you will have pockets. In these pockets, you can have color, and these colors can be mixed with the glue, and this glue will be injected on top of a layer of polymer. If you want ceramic, if you want whatever it is, you just spray it. And finally, what you get is a green part. This green part is used for several applications. For example, architect wants to show. If you want to show the topology of a place, for example, a landscape has to be shown in front of maybe a prime minister is visiting. You want to show a landscape of your college. So then this 3D inkjet printing, color inkjet printing can be used. You can quickly make the landscape. Whatever color you give, it quickly gets printed, and then you see it wonderful. You can't make the entire print in one shot. So what we use is we use the unit cell concept, build unit cell after unit cell on unit cell, then join it together, make an output and get the required output, whatever you want. So the last process, what we wanted to discuss, which is not so easily available or not very much talked about, is loam. Loam is also used for making rapid tooling and other toy entertainment industry products we can make. So this is also exhaustively used for several applications. So when you are trying to build, today when I talk to you about the mass customization, people have started building their own bikes. So they designed their own bike. If you look for last 100 years or 125 years, the design of a frame for the bicycle has never changed. Only the last 20 years, you see different cycle frames coming into existence. Now people are aware of the loading conditions and the mixed loads, for example, shear strength, mixed loading pattern. For that, they have started designing their own bicycles, own forks, own handles. So that is made by metal printers. So again, a non-engineering application. So they have started making it. So they have also started using it for mold making. So this is for a CNC, it takes such a long time. So in 3D printing, it does not take such a long time. People used to say in 3D printing, you always try to get a very rough surface. It is not true. See, earlier, what we used to do is we used to have uniform EZ layer thickness formed when the layer by layer is getting built. Today, what has happened, the nozzle which is used have been now made out of piezo actuators. Moment you have a piezo actuator, the flow of a material could be controlled to a large extent. So the slice which is used has become very thin. And on top of it, the concept of adaptive slicing has also come into existence. So because of that, the building up time is reduced to a large extent. Of course, even after doing so, you will always have an error called a staircase error. So the staircase effect error has to be minimized. So we look for several of the post-processing processes. People have started designing their own guitar. And pretty interesting, I have seen a violin which is made out of rapid prototyping. The best part of it is acoustically awesome. You plan your own guitar, you plan your own violin. You have a mixture of wood and rapid prototyping in guitar. So this gives you lightweight, already it is lightweight, but it can further reduce, and it gives you a wonderful acoustic control. So here are some of the applications. And when we start using this rapid prototyping, I would like to bring to your notice, friends, that we should not try to take the existing product and just repeat the same. For example, you have a cell phone. If you take the cell phone, which is cuboidal in shape, and reprint the same cuboidal shape with rapid prototyping, it is not going to help you in improvising the product. In rapid prototyping, we are also talking about topology optimization. You look at the product, medical product, which was developed. This is what is a product which is conventionally used today. And this product is completely redesigned, wherein which it can take load, and there are reinforcements given. The design is redone, optimized. The weight has gone down. The loads can go very high. The fatigue cycle loading has been tested, and it has performed very well. So it finds a lot of applications in personal manufacturing, medical applications, aerospace, architecture, automobile, agriculture, and visual aid. So these are some of the entertainment industry which I have already discussed with you, some in aerospace, some in medical applications, some in prototyping in visual architecture. You can see in personalized way how have they done, and you can also see how they have done 3D printing guns for several of the applications. iPhone casing. So this is mass customization, iPhone casing. So today you go choose the design and tell it, they'll print and you can just put on top of your phone. Then interiors, then there is a huge business and money which has been invested by Government of India on the Archaeology Society of India. They are now started moving between temples wherein which they wanted to record, digitize the ancient architecture and then start developing prototypes so that this can give you a sale of the artifacts. So temple pillars are getting printed today. In biomedical applications, the patch which was there missing, they have done a counterpart and then they have covered it on top of the skull and they have started using. In fact, we started working with King George Medical College. We developed an artificial ear with out of silicon, and then what we did was we added two stubs of magnet. And the idea was to give it to a person who was ready. We were decided to make an operation in a skull and place two counter magnets there. And he can place his ear as and when it is required or not. So it was almost to the final, but at the ethical cell level, we got defeated. So we stopped there. But you can see that the artificial ear, missing part, dissecting part, all these things can be done by rapid prototyping for understanding or for demonstration. So this is a cycle which I'm showing it in front of you, was developed at IIT Kanpur, and we worked with King George Medical College. So we made nose, we made ears, we gave it a color exactly matching to the color of the face. So we did that, and then we developed it, but finally we could not get. So you can see scanned data, we could get the final thing done within 3 days time. So this is it's not only for human being, there are also handicapped animals, and there are today a lot of the animal lovers are there. We could do it. Recently for a peacock, we made a reinforcement which we could give it for peacock's leg, just as a hobby we did. And then we gave it to the veterinary science. With the veterinary department, we are also started working very closely in developing such fixtures for animals. For example, for cow, for dogs, we are making it through ape polymers and then we are giving it to it. Some of the world's first 3D printed plane, which is done, a jet engine, and then 3D parts printed for multiple nozzles for ejection. These are some of the things. GE has reduced its nozzle parts. 19 parts have been reduced to one. The overall weight has gone down by maybe 1 kilo or so. They say it's a huge reduction for them. These are architectural applications, which now if you want to make it takes a hell of a lot of time. If you print it, you get the entire print done within a week. This is what I told you for construction industry. They have been using it. 3D printing of houses, which is done and demonstrated. IIT Madras has demonstrated it. and developed countries have started already using it. It is, and they have also made it very interesting. During COVID, I think Finland has developed a 3D printed construction house, which is dismantleable. It is all made modular. The hospital is made, and once the hospital, the COVID gets over, they dismantle it and they wanted to make it into a school. So a completely 3D printed car, which is used, wherein the outer casing is made by 3D printing, which finds application. These are the parts which have been made out of ABS. And the weight reduction, which we earlier thought it could be made only by metals, are now done by polymers for bumper, for the structure which is there. So there is a huge weight reduction. And it's not only the weight reduction, the engine noise reduction also happens if you start playing with the structure. If you take any plastic chair, the chair what we sit, Neil Kamal chair or whatever it is, Syntex chair, you just do it like you turn it up, flip it up, you will see ribs there. These ribs are the structural load-bearing members for the weight, whatever we sit. So that tries to take the load.
Sir,
so
can we just wrap it up quickly? The next talk is at 12, and okay. We have a couple of questions also. So.
Okay. So this is for agricultural implements, which has been made. These are some of the connectors which are done. Okay. This is what, as I was talking to you about the guitar. These are the dresses. Interestingly, the fashion designers are using it, and all these things are 3D printed, sir. All these things are 3D printed. We have also, we can also see this metal, this melted plastic, wherein which you can start drawing it and developing it. This is again a 3D printing pen, which is available today, which is used for a visual aid for entertainment industry. So today we have moved from 3D to 4D. So we are also trying to give the fourth effect. Apart from this, so 3D printed part, and you try to create an ambience. In this ambience, the part starts dancing or the part start getting activated. So it is also used for 4D printing technique today. So these are some of the 4D printing techniques which are available today. The future scope is very high. So to conclude, we can see personal rapid prototyping machines, higher and diversified functionality for visual aids. Finally, to conclude, I would put it in this way. You have a very capable tool in front of you, very economical way of developing products in front of you. You as an individual has to be smart enough to tweak the tool to your requirements. With that few words, thank you so much for your kind attention, and I'll be happy to take up some questions. Thank you.
So the questions are mentioned in the chat window.
Okay.
Shall I read it out?
It will be nice if you could read it out, sir.
What are the future perspective of career in additive manufacturing?
Infinity, sir. It's infinity. So future perspective is all depends on you. You have to think big. You have to look forward for applications. Let me tell you one simple example. My wife, she is working as a school teacher. She is now, she has been a teacher for a long, and she has not graduated from LKG. She is an LKG teacher for almost 8 years. Now she has been asked to teach the kids online. She has been working so hard because she does not know her customer. The customer cannot pick a pencil and write. She has to engage them for 45 minutes. She has to teach them English. She has to teach them a character, then a word, then a sentence, then a poem. Then she has to also keep them engaged for 45 minutes. Look at the challenge. She's been working. She uses PowerPoint. She dances. She does video. She does audio. Boss, she does everything. So what I'm trying to impress you is, it is you who have to become innovative to use this powerful tool in front of you. The jewelry example was from a remote village near to my hometown, whose turnover is 1 crore. It is only because of its innovative capability. Tirupur is a village which was there 40, 50 years back. Today it is a district, and you see a lot of infinity business coming out. People are smart, people are innovative, people are enterprising. You have infinite is a business possibility for secondary structures and non-engineering applications. Okay, next question, please.
Could you kindly elaborate on 3D printing and prototyping of energy sector, like insulators, alternators, motors, etc., or batteries? Can we build a rapid prototyping of a battery or a sensor?
Yes. So, sorry, I am trying to give a lot of my own examples, my wife, my son. This is only to tell that I use this. Okay, we are now working with a startup company, which is a US-based startup company for lithium-ion battery, and we are also making hydrogen fuel cells for them. We completely build our prototypes. It's not only the dabba outside, it's also the layers in between, and then we also try to make the layers, we keep inserts and we do it. So we make prototypes. So battery, we are there, we make prototypes, that's there. As far as the pumps or other thing concerned, see, gentlemen, today you should understand the business. In business today, we always keep talking about only big pumps. So let us take fish tank pumps. 90% of the business in fish tank pumps comes from China. 90% of the Tulu pumps, which is used for this water cooling, desert cooler, comes from China. So we have to do reverse engineering. We have to improvise the product. There is huge business there. And we are now also working on smog tower, small smog towers for room applications, okay, for filtering process. So we have started making our own motors, small casings and then small interfacings. So in energy industry also, it plays a very, very important role. So I'm repeatedly saying, you have to look for a business. You look for a business. You identify a business, look at this machine, ask this machine what it can do. And I'm repeatedly telling you, you have to do post-processing, which is very, very powerful. You have to be innovative in making this post-processing. Energy industry for weight reduction, yes. Okay, for weight reduction, remanufacturing, reworking, yes. For redesigning, yes. GE has reworked their entire impeller and reduced the weight to from 1 kilo to 600 grams. They have reduced it already. They are using it. Majority of the GE parts for secondary applications are done by rapid prototyping. Next question, please.
Sir, there's a final set of questions. Yes. What sort of qualification is required for additive manufacturing parts for engineering application? Are there any standards for rotating additive manufactured parts?
Okay, so first thing is the basic qualification you need is you need to understand the machine. You need to be creative. Today is an era of collaboration. So you have to be looking for an application. Rest all, there are people who can do. So it does not matter you are a diploma guy, BSc guy, BTech guy, does not matter at all for the business. Second question is, this
rapid. Are there any standards for rotating additive manufactured parts?
Yes, so let me come to that. See, today what has happened is that additive manufacturing still it is in a growing era. So even now, the standards are not very well established across the globe. There are big efforts which have been done by ASME and Indian Bureau Standards Bureau also is working on it to establish standards. So the standards are not still available because here what you get built is anisotropic material. So anisotropic material with varying orientation, varying tool path. You try to get multiple different properties. So the standards are still getting developed. There are no standards identified. Like composites, even today there is not much standards available. So this rapid prototyping also does not have standards. It is getting evolved, and over a period of time, yes, I think it will get matured.